Good job, Peter. Good job. I ask you to give me five. Welcome to church. It's great to see everybody. Read those announcements in the bulletin. I just have one I want to punch up. But before I do that, I want to say praise the Lord for Scout Sunday. We had a contingent of scouts at first service. It is the 107th anniversary. Scout Sunday is always held near to the anniversary of the time when it began. It's the 107th anniversary of scouting this year. Our troop is a good troop, and how many of you, I hope all of you, and if you haven't, do it on your way out. It's even better at night. But how many of you noticed the burn that contains three beautiful crosses on Tennessee Avenue? Anybody noticed it? So they have. That was Zach Losey's Eagle Project. And he made his Eagle Project a witness for the Lord. And I just want to say praise God for that. And Zach's going to read the liturgy right after we sing the first song. But the announcement I want to share with you about is for the Ministry Council. The Ministry Council has fallen into disrepair, and we're starting it again a week from Monday, on the 20th of February. And at that meeting, it'll be an hour long. It's not going to drag on and on. And at that meeting, our new Ministry Council chair, who's Lisa Hutchison right up there. Lisa Hutchison's not up there. She was there at first service, but now she's teaching Sunday school. She'll be the chairman of that committee, and we're going to do a brainstorming time. If you're interested in the ministry of this church and would like to brainstorm with staff and folks in the church, please come a week from Monday night to the Ministry Council. Are the chimers ready? Let's do it. Go. Thank you. let's stand and sing our first song.
Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
O Lord our God, there are many places we could go this morning, but we have desired to come to your house. There are many voices to which we can listen today, but we desire to hear your voice. Easy to scatter, but we have chosen to gather. We need to behold your beauty, inquire in your temple, to be wrapped in your love, and to experience your renewing spirit. Come close, Lord Jesus, to fill us and renew us. Let's sing. Before we receive our offering, let's pray this prayer together. Gracious God, use these gifts that you have given us to feed others as we have been fed, to serve others as we have been served, to bless others as we have been blessed, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gift of giving, for allowing us the privilege of participating in the work of heaven here on earth through these gifts. Lord, we count this our citizenship of heaven duty, and we pray that you would use these gifts for your great good in this world, and for the sake of the gospel, and for the sake of making disciples for you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Greet each other in the name of the Lord. And have a seat. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for allowing us to assemble, to gather in your name and in this place. We thank you for the gift of salvation that you have made possible for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for completing your work of salvation, for making us holy through the gift and the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we love you, and we lean on you. We look around us in this world, and we see such great needs. We see anger and hatred. We see violence, and we ask God for the grace to so live the love of your Son, Jesus, in the midst of this dark world, that others will see and know and long to be a part of your church. Lord, we thank you for the legacy of scouting. And we pray your blessing on our scout leaders, our scouts, and all of those who take of their time to pour their lives into these young men. Bless them, bless the Girl Scouts, and use it all for your great good and glory. We pray for our leaders. We lift them up to you, both on the national level and on the state and local levels. And Lord, we ask for your wisdom and your spirit to guide them in all that they do. We pray for our bishop and the decisions that he, along with the cabinet, will be making soon. We ask God for your guidance, your blessing, and your ministry there. We pray for our building committee, for your wisdom to attend them, and for your grace to go with them. We pray, God, for a fresh wind of your Holy Spirit to blow through our midst. And we thank you, God, for the way in which you will speak to us through Pastor Lori and through the Juarez mission team this day. Thank you for the testimony of their lives and their actions. And thank you, Lord, for the testimony of their lips. Give them your word and allow them to share freely and fully all that you would have them share this day. And we'll give you the praise and the glory. Lord, we want to be the church that serves and gives selflessly. We want to be the church that reflects your love for all of the citizens of this world who are potential citizens of heaven. Oh, guide, guard, and bless us this day. Be with those in the hospital. Be with those who are anticipating hospital stays or those who've just been released. Pour out your healing upon us as a church and bless us in every way. This we pray in the name that is above every other name, Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home.
When Jesus is meeting you. Our scripture comes from Philippians, and we just keep going along here. Philippians 3, verses 12 to 4, 1. And I invite you to, as we read this, kind of think about, are there words that kind of stick out for you, words that pop for you, that kind of hone in on? What are those words? Philippians 3. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect. But I press on to take hold of that which Jesus Christ took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining on towards what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me, heaven in Christ Jesus. All of us are mature, spiritually mature, should take a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join with others in following my example, brothers and sisters, and take note of those who live according to the pattern that we gave you. For as I have often told you before, and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Therefore, my brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, that is how you should stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. So maybe this is the word of the Lord. Okay, so this is like a pep talk that Paul is giving to the church in Philippi, to the people in Philippi, Roman citizens, but also citizens of God, of heaven, followers of Christ. So they have like a dual citizenship. So keep that in mind. This is a pep talk that Paul is giving to the people in Philippi. And so there's some kind of pep talk language within there, right? I mean, it's like, press on. Look for the goal. Keep going. Stand firm in Christ. Stand firm in Christ. Sometimes we need that pep talk. Sometimes we need to be reminded that we are not only citizens here on earth, but we're also citizens of heaven. And that should make us different people, should it not? Shouldn't we be different because of that dual citizenship that we have? Shouldn't our actions be different? Our decisions be different? Our posture be different? I see your minds thinking about it. You're kind of thinking about it. Okay. You know, we're multifaceted people. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a multifaceted person. Okay, so you know what that means. I mean, like, we're different. I am a daughter and a sister and a wife and a mother and a runner and a biker and
a friend,
a citizen of the United States, and a Christian. And all of those different things make me different. I make different decisions because of that. I make different actions because of those things. I have a different posture. I'm going to invite those that went to Juarez to come up because their decisions, their actions, their posture have made them called from by God to go to a different place. And I want them to tell you about their trip. But not just, it wasn't just a trip, like, you know, let's go down to Mexico and let's see what we can do. It was, are you getting the lower chair? What's the? They're different people because of this trip. They came back changed because, not just because of their interaction with each other, which part of it, but part of it is because of what they did. What they were able to do in the name of Jesus Christ. And so I want you to hear about, are you settled in there?
No.
Our citizenship calls us to be different. It calls us to be different. At first, we're different because of the decisions that we make. At least I hope you are different people because of the decisions that you make in the name of Jesus. In the pep talk, I like the words about pressing on towards the goal because we have a good message. We have a good news to share with the world. And so we have to press on, and some of that means leaving behind some things. Leaving behind maybe the regrets, leaving behind the would've, should've's kind of thing. Maybe leaving behind the sin so that we can press on, makes us to have different decisions. You'll see up there pictures of their trip. They're going to go around and around, so if you miss it the first time, it'll be there the second time around or something like that. It just keeps going. But I think about the decisions that we make and pressing on towards the goal. It took them a little bit to come together. I think God brings people together when it comes to a mission trip.
Amen.
And this group, they started off, Amy kind of started us off in this direction because of her brother. So you want to talk about that a little bit, about what are decisions that you made that pushed you forward to do this, to go to on a mission trip?
Well, I want to give you the background of this ministry. My brother Brad is a pastor, and he's ordained, and when you get ordained in the United Methodist Conference, they always take the new ordained pastors on a trip, generally to the Holy Land. Well, the year that my brother got ordained with his friend Bill, the conference said, sorry, we can't afford it. We're sending you to Juarez, Mexico. And the guys are like, dude, we are not going to Juarez. You know, they were like, it's not right. But they did go because they had to. But both Brad and Bill left their hearts down there. This ministry in particular has suffered over the years. Back in the early 90s is when it began, and it was a big deal. It's a United Methodist ordained ministry down there. The United Methodist Church of Mexico hosts it. We stay in the United Methodist Volunteer in Mission House. Back when it started, they had 35 to 45 weeks filled a year with youth groups and adult teams going down to build homes. So they were building over 40 homes a year for people in this area. But then 9/11 hit, and it became a lot harder to cross the border. You had to have your passports. And then in the late 2000s, there was a lot of strife down there. The drug cartels were warring over territory, and innocent people were getting killed, and it was a very dangerous place. So it has dwindled to only Brad's church and his friend Bill's church going down to RS. So instead of 45 homes a year, it has gone down to 2 homes a year in an area that is desperate for need. So for me, getting into this, I've heard about this for years, and it always was, nice, Brad, I'm so proud of you. You're doing a good job. Keep going. You know, good for you. But this past year when they went, I watched the video and I looked at the pictures. And, you know, I know that when you're ready, God starts nudging you. So I just felt this nudge that, you know, this is cool. You know, for VBS, we always raise money for a mission. That's what we'll do this year. I brought it to the team and I said, is it a possibility that we can use all of our coins this year to build a house in Juarez? Everybody was on board. So we thought, okay, $2,700 builds this 25 by 18 cinder block house. $2,700. So I thought, okay, VBS doesn't usually bring in that much. We bring in about $2,000, which is amazing for change. So we brought all of you on board and asked you to step in there with us. And you are amazing. Because not only did we raise enough money for one house, we are almost to 4 homes. That last night at VBS, when we were talking about it, I was crying, and I don't cry because it's the rules, no crying. It was just amazing that we had all this money to build these homes in Juarez, and I didn't feel like we could just send a check then. And Kristen came up to me that night and says, we're going to go, right? And I can't tell Kristen no. So I'm like, oh, okay, we'll go. Okay, exactly. I guess we're going to go build a house that our kids helped raise money for. So that's why I went.
I'll piggyback on that. Yeah, so the whole week of VBS, you know, I'm helping and I'm seeing these kids bring in their pennies and their dimes and nickels and everything, and they're getting so excited, and I'm thinking to myself, wow, like, this is really cool, and we have such a connection. Like, we can get there. Like, usually I'm like, oh, yeah, that's great. But we know Brad, and he's gone down for 14 years. Like, we can get there. So yeah, the last night, emotional as it was, when I said to Amy, let's go, I thought it wasn't going to happen. There's no way this is going to happen. She's not on board. And then she announced in the fall that we were going. And then I kind of panicked. Like, okay, I said we were going to do this. We got to do this.
You had to go be my buddy.
I did. I had to go be her buddy. And I did. And I have zero regrets. But that was, I felt a pull. Like, there was just something. I had to do it. I've wanted to do missions, and, you know, I figure if I go down to Haiti or something like that and play with kids, I'm going to bring them back with me, so I couldn't do that, so I thought, okay, I'll go and build a house, and yeah, it was
and
amazing.
And that pull is a God thing.
It absolutely
is. That pull is a God thing, but there's also, you know, there's a God thing that works in spouses, right, Eric?
Yeah, okay. So it could be a push, too.
A push or a pull.
So Celeste and I heard about the mission in the fall, and I'd not been on a mission trip before. But I thought, yeah, that's something I could do, but I'm thinking that to myself in my head. I could do that. And then Celeste finds Amy and Lori and says, Eric will go. So, but I really, I felt I needed to go because there's a couple guys that helped us out. In the early 90s, they helped us build a house. So I decided I would, young family, I decided I was going to build a house. And I wasn't sure how I was going to do it. I knew I could do it, but I didn't know how. My parents had taught me how to work and how to do those kinds of things and gave me the confidence to do it. But still got to do it. So these two guys, they said they'd help. And So they'd come and show up, and first month they were there. And they kept coming back. And 6 months later, we got a house done, you know, and family was there to help. But these two guys were big parts of that. And I really couldn't repay them. I just asked, so, and they just told me, well, help other, down the road, you'll find something you can do. You can help somebody else out.
So you've been blessed.
So that's why I went.
Others can be blessed because of that same blessing that you've received. It wasn't easy for you guys to go, was it? Or it was an easy decision.
It was an easy decision.
It was an easy decision. Okay.
For her, she had to nudge me a little bit.
I just knew. I knew it was definitely the first time that I've had the opportunity to answer a really strong call. When I heard about the trip, I just knew that I was going. I didn't feel like I need to make this decision. The decision was already made. I was going, and then nothing could stop me or him indirectly.
That's right.
I was nervous about you two going. I was. I mean, they left their kids. I mean, you know, these people up here, they took time off from work or, you know, and family, and they left it all behind. And that was a hard decision, I think. I mean, it was easy, you said, because you knew God was calling you. But, gosh, it's got to be a hard decision also at the same time.
Well, they even had naysayers. People they told about going were like, why are you going down there?
I mean, that's just pretty amazing that you would say, okay, I'm taking a week off of work to go build a house in Mexico. I mean, that's just pretty amazing that God can nudge you that way, that your decisions, because of your citizenship in heaven, because of your faith in Christ, you feel the call from God to go do something, to make that decision. And that reflects in the actions that you take. So in this particular scripture of Philippians, I'm thinking about, you know, that goal that's before us and leaving stuff behind, and it just really speaks to my runner's heart. And I'm thinking about, you know, there you are at the beginning, and you're ready to go, and you're ready to see that finish line. But really, it's the journey along the way. It's not just the beginning and the end of the race. It's the journey along the way. It's the actions that you take. Now, there are those ovals, you know, on cars that have like 26.2 and 13.1 and
0.0. Woo!
0.0. I mean... There are those that you know, that maybe don't run a long ways, but, you know, it's making the decision. It's taking the action of getting in the race. And Paul's pep talk is telling us, you know, we have to make those decisions. We have to make the decisions and then follow it up with action. We have to run forward. We have a goal. We have a place that we're going to, and we need to take action. So there's some actions that this team took as they were down in Mexico. I think about the actions while you were down there. How did they strengthen your faith? How did you feel while you were down there? How did the actions that you had, how did they strengthen your faith?
We'll start at that end.
Yep, go for it.
Jay.
It's hard to put into words sometimes, isn't it? Because it's like you want to just take them down there and have them experience the same thing.
It just felt good to just be something that was bigger than yourself.
Mm-hmm. Ah.
For me.
They built two houses in 3 days.
3 days.
And that's a God thing. To be able to build two houses in 3 days, that's a God thing.
You know, when you go, you just leave everything at home. So I don't have to worry about doing the mom thing or taking care of the home or doing work. You strip all of that away and you leave it at the border, and then you cross over and God is just so big, and your connection is stronger, and there's not all of those distractions to take you away from growing closer to God. And I feel like you see God everywhere there. The beautiful mountains that you're surrounded by as you're working on building a house on top of a dump, and you look up and there's a cross on the mountain. And the nature is beautiful, and then you look people in the eye, and you can just see God in them. Just, it's everywhere. It's so big.
Okay, you want me to go?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. Oh, for me, it was, we're on the site, and it's hard work, but I was so excited to watch the house keep getting to be a home. And I so wanted to bring all the kids down, so they could stand around and watch what they have accomplished. And we even on Wednesday morning did a live video that we sent, so they were able to play it to the kids on Wednesday night during watch. And my understanding is the kids were just absolutely thrilled because they took part in that, because mission can start at such a young age.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting. It's Scout Sunday, because it reminded me kind of going to camp as a kid, and you leave school behind, friends behind, or whatever, and you would go, and that's kind of what this was. We would we went to camp, but it was a very different place, and so it reminded me a lot of that, and it was a great experience in that respect.
Ditto. I'm just kidding.
You were a Boy Scout?
Wow. Yes.
Yeah, she probably was.
I agree with all their comments. Same with Nikki. You'd stop on the work site and just look at the scenery. And there's garbage on the ground. Whatever you can think of is on the ground. Your garbage is on the ground. Their garbage is on the ground. But it was so beautiful because... you see all these people coming together who don't even know each other, and they're building this house with the family. It's just, it was, yes, so many God moments.
And you didn't want to go, remember?
Stop it. It's not that I didn't want to go.
She wanted to go. She was just nervous about going.
Yes.
But tell us about some of the people that you met down there. You tell us about the Brenda.
So Brenda was the mom we were building the house for. She was 22. She's the one with kind of the red hair in the pictures. And her son, Gustavo, was 2. And then Brenda's mom, Brenda, which was very confusing, helped as well. And young Brenda's brother,
Manuel,
not Emmanuel, Manuel.
It's Emmanuel.
We're not sure what his name was. I'm just kidding. They all helped, and they had such a spirit and a drive. They're the hardest workers, and they just had a passion for it. The last day, Brenda, the mom, was literally raking garbage away from her daughter's house to make it look more like a house. Like, we were all just like, wow. Like, she's taking such pride in this house that we just built her, and they were turning it into a home as we were standing there. So it was really... really neat to see.
So that pride thing, that's what kept coming back to me. Pride in what we were doing and that we were building a house. And going, I wasn't, I knew the kind of work we were going to do, but how we were going to accomplish it was a question. But it was amazing to me, this group and then the bigger group, how hard everybody worked whether it was mixing mortar or concrete or laying block or whatever it was, everybody was doing their part. And it was amazing to me how that all came together. And I looked at the people that were there and the conditions that they lived in, but they had, great pride in their homes. And they dressed impressively. They walked to work to catch the bus to go to work. And I think what I came away with is that God empowers us to overcome challenges, whatever they might be. Our little challenge for 3 days of 3-4 days building these houses, but their daily challenge of what they endure, and that left an impression on me.
Mm-hmm. God empowers us to overcome our challenges. Yeah. Children were there too. You were able to give things out to kids, which is just right up your alley.
One of the things before we went, Brad said, bring some extra money. We'll stop at Target before we cross the border, and we're going to buy gifts for the kids. So luckily, we had taken quite a bit of money and spent about $200 on balls and bubbles and crayons and paper. And the first day, you had a smattering of a few kids come to the site, and they're so thrilled to get presents, toys. Then the next day they brought more friends, and each day we get more kids, and we were just passing out gift upon gift, and they were so excited. And then we got to play soccer with them. It was a great time, and just to give that was such a joy.
So that was God using you even beyond building the houses. You're interacting with the people and making decisions and helping people along the way. There's a story about a girl was talking to her teacher, and the teacher asked, you know, how far can you see? And she said, well, you know, I can see out on a sunny day out past those fields, you know, it's a few miles out that way, and I can see about that far. And the teacher said, well, on a clear day, can you see the sun? And, well, yeah. It says, well, how far away is that? You know, millions of miles. So it's about perspective or posture. I said it makes a difference, your posture, because of the verse that says stand in Christ. And I think about that as your posture. Not that you're better than somebody, but, you know, humble is our first posture. But our perspective, you know, we can see things that are right here. But when we really look, we can see things far away. And as citizens of Jesus, as followers of Christ, you know, we take care of things right here, and that's great, but we're also called to take care of things in the bigger world, to have a stand for God in the whole world. And that's hard to do. That's hard to do when we feel small. But if we have that idea that we stand for Christ, we have the posture of standing for Christ, then we can have a bigger perspective. God gives us the strength that we need. And so we need to live out our faith. And we do it by the decisions we make, the actions we take, the posture that we hold. So the team went, and then they came back home, and they're different people now. You're different people because of that. So what did you bring home? What difference did this mission trip make in your life?
Go ahead.
Okay. So, like in Paul's pep talk, just press on, okay? I learned the first day I was, you know, just a little nervous about being there, and I learned to just press on, just keep going, keep moving, because you know what? This isn't my mission. This is God's mission for me, and just do it. And by the last day, I didn't want to leave. So I learned that. I gained, plus Marge Orth, who's not here, she was wonderful too. I gained 5 best friends. They're stuck with me. Sorry, guys. And 5 best friends that, you know, like coming to church 4 Sundays ago, like I knew them, I'd say hi, but never, ever, ever would I have ever imagined that we would have the connection we have now. So I brought that home with me. I brought the just supercharged all around. So that's what I brought home with me.
And vanilla that you threw out, is that, you brought that home?
No. Was it good vanilla, though?
Yeah, my phone battery's not the same, that's for sure. Blowing up every day with text messages.
Yeah, we're continuing to text, like 30, 40 messages a day.
God brought this group together. What's the difference in your life now because of this trip, besides the text message?
I think something for me is some of these factories that we would drive by to the work site, like U.S. automotive factories, these people that would be able to go on these buses, they'd be going, they're making $7 a week.
Wow.
So their fuel down there was $4 and something cents a gallon. I don't even know how these people are filling their cars up. I just came home with a sense of perspective about how much we actually have. Mm-hmm. It's a big reality check.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We got it good here.
When you were down there, there's no television while you were there. And mm-hmm. and they don't have it either. I mean, right? Or they do. Some of them do.
Some do.
Some do. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're informed. The people were informed and educated. They knew
good.
What was going on in the world.
Yeah.
I mean, I think they looked at us like we were the, obviously different. And so it was good to, you know, they got to know us a little bit. But I thought that was a good exchange as well.
To add to what Jay was saying, you do come home feeling just amazingly blessed.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a big wake-up call to what you have. But I think that it also is a big call to turn that around and give just as you said in scripture earlier, we have so much and we are called to give so much.
This neighborhood, this area, is built on a landfill that they filled over. And to hear the stories of how they pick people to get a house. In the old days, they used to drive through the neighborhood with applications when they had so many groups coming. Now it's just our volunteer in mission, Jose Luis, who's down there. He drives through the neighborhood to find the greatest need. And in particular, last year, Bill was telling me the group that they built a house for was a mother and son. She was in her 50s. She was both blind and deaf, and she lived in like a doghouse-sized thing with pallets and cardboard covering her. And her son lived next to her. He had dug a hole and put cardboard over the top, and that's where he slept at night. So that's how they live, and so they were chosen last year to receive a home. And that's how a lot of them are. Our Brenda was living with a friend. She didn't have anything. She worked at the local S-Mart, which was a grocery store down there, and they don't make a lot. I mean, the peso to a dollar, I mean, it's good for us to go down there and spend money, but wow, how unfortunate for them. And what I brought back was just a new passion for mission. Throughout the week, both Pastor Brad and Pastor Bill kept encouraging us, saying, a mission-oriented and a mission-minded church is a growing church. That is what they gave us throughout the week. And it's so true, because you feel going down there and just giving of ourselves, you just felt God's power overwhelming, and just we were there. And to see their smiles and to do something. I mean, we stood there looking at our finished house, wishing we could build on the bathroom and build on a kitchen and run pipes for running water. We wanted to do more, and we weren't able to at this time. But what a blessing. It is just a drive that we have to go down again. And I know throughout the world needs people. The world needs people not to just write a check, but to go and share God's love, to build bridges of love, because that's what we're called to do. We are called to be a community. And I have this new passion, and we are going again next year. So I hope that you're ready to join us.
Well, I like what you said about bridges of love.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's, you know, that's what your decisions, your actions, the way you're going, this is building a bridge of love. And as citizens of heaven, as followers of Christ, that's what we're being called to do over and over and over again. And sometimes it's here locally, you know, whether it's at the Ridge, you know, at our children's homes,
yes.
Whatever it is. Maybe it's further away. Maybe it is in Mexico. Maybe it's, you know, in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever it is, take a stand. A stand for Christ. Let's pray. Gracious, loving God, we thank you so much for calling this group to serve you in mission, for calling all of us as a church to be a mission-oriented church, one that sees the needs in our world and then reaches out and makes a difference. Help us to stand for Christ wherever we go, for we have good news. We have good news to share, that you love us. Help us to build those bridges of love throughout our life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able when we're singing our closing hymn.
invite the team to come over here, and as you exit, if you would take a moment to talk to them and greet them, that would be great. We do go out with grace alone. God's grace gives us the strength we need. So go now in God's grace and God's love. Let's sing our last verse one more time.
Grace onward we
Have a great day.